with an introduction to Rapid Minor Practice. Then see how to import the data set to Rapid Minor. Then some basic analysis, visually available represent, available to data aggregation, some data trade processing or cleanup activities like handling missing values. Then how to save the data after some analysis. Output, how will you save it, that we'll see. Then we'll discuss the unsupervised learning techniques like data validation techniques, principal component analysis, cluster analysis. Afterwards, the different predictive modeling techniques, different ways of developing models and validating the models. So this RapidMiner is an open source package. So anybody can download it from their website. The latest version is 7.5, RapidMiner Studio 7.5. You can install any number of times. Every time you have to register, you give your email ID and register. Otherwise, it is free only. But free with some restrictions, some around 20,000 records only, you will take a free version. But for academic purpose and all, you can use this package. There are other open source packages are also available like R, Python. But RapidMiner, one advantage is it is a graphical user interface system. We need not write any programming code or comments. All are remote driven packages. That way you can do the analysis. That is one advantage. But Python and R, you have to learn R code on Python screens. Here that is not required. So we start with how to import some data set to RapidMiner, then do some pre-processing activities in RapidMiner, and then how to save the output or export the output back to some other file format. That part we start with the data. So all of your system, this is installed in RapidMiner, you open it. Thank you. I'll show you what is the game. You will open the Rapid Miner. Once you install it, you get the Rapid Miner icon in the desktop. The bitplate it will open. Then we are starting one analysis, new analysis. We have to take it as a new process. If you have already done some analysis and saved it, half done means you can open the process and open the old process. When a new analysis we are starting, we start with the new process. Given to you. It is from one telecom company. The file name is missing value, missing underscore values underscore telecom. Some memo data set is there around 20 records. In this data set, this is the file. It's an Excel file. Import this data set to Rapid Miner and this wherever blanks are there, what they are missing values. We will have to take one of the methods to take the missing values, we will see first.
Thank you.
rapidly folder in your desktop, no? Now to import to the data set, the different file formats it will support. Excel is one, CSV. Then you can directly import from your databases also. So how to do that, I will tell you. So all the operations are done through one operator in rapid manner. So whatever analysis, whatever activity we want to do, the corresponding operator we have to use. And the list of operators are here. This is the operator window. Under all this, each one subfolders, lot of operators are there. Now to read one, this is an Excel file. Now to read the Excel file, we read this operator. Read Excel, one operator is there. Using that operator, we can read the Excel file. Now, in RapidMiner 7.5, this operator will be under data access, files, read, and then inside it comes the read Excel operator. But in this version, RapidMiner 5, I think it is under import. If you go to import, data, then you can see different ways you can read the different formats or operator for you. But you need not remember all these things, no? You can just type it here, read Excel, then it will show that. So, the operator is under which group we need not remember, we have only remember the operator to use. So, you just type the name, it will come, right? So, this read Excel operator we'll use. So, what you have to do is, to use this operator, all of you got it, no? Read Excel, yeah? It is under import data, it comes. Path and all you don't remember, only the operator name you have to see. Now to use it, we have to drag this to the process window. Just drag from left and drop it on the process window. To read an Excel file, we have to use read Excel operator. So it is under import data and or you just type read Excel, you will know that in the operator window will come, you have to drop to the processing. Now we have to set up this operator. It's the path and all we have to do. So for that, this we can use import configuration wizard, no? That you can use. You just click on that, select this operator and click on that. So once an operator is grabbed to the process, then you go to that properties and you have to set the properties. Here you have to give the path, where is that file, all details you have to give. So that can be run through this import wizard. So click on that. So this file open dialog box will come. Then you browse to that folder. This is desktop. No? Data set. This is the file name required. Shall I do once again? Once you drag and drop the read Excel operator, then you click on this configuration wizard. So once the operator is wrapped into the process window, then we have to set up the operator parameters. So simple way is you go to import missile, then it will open the file open dialog box. You browse to the folder where the data is there. This system, it is in the desktop, rapid miner folder. Read Excel operator. Now we'll go by step, no? You click on the next button. So it gives you a preview of the data in that particular file. Next.
Sir, after choosing desktop,
you can extract this folder, where the data is there. Data sets, within that, missing value telephone file. Click this. Suppose you don't want any particular fail, you can remove that by unchecking this box, checkbox. Suppose serial number you don't want, means you uncheck, means this particular column or field it will not import. Only the other ones it will import. So by default it will import all the fields or all the columns in your data set. But if you don't want, you can remove that. Then each of the fields, there are the types will be specified here. So the different types are, it can be attribute, nominal, it will be nominal, numeric, integer, binomial, polynomial, different types of data, what type of data contains in that field, that's what it will display there. So if it is not correctly chosen, you can use this drop down list and change it. For the time being, it has taken everything. So this has numeric. This all are numeric, no? This also you can take it as numeric. Numeric means it is numbers. Polynomial means some categories, 1, 2, 3, 4, or low, medium, high. That all are polynomials. And the last field is anyway, it is a polynomial, A, B, C, D. So it will be like that. All others you can keep it as a numeric field. So whenever it is not doing correctly, you can check that and change it. If it's a real number, you can choose as real, integer, like that. Now the second one is, below that there is another set of drop-down list also. So every variable or every field which we read into R package, it classifies into different types. One of the type is ID column. Suppose it is an ID, then you have to choose it as an ID column. That means a primary key like that. That will not be used for any analysis. So one is ID. Then the second one is most of the time we will be developing under data mining, we will be developing the model. Model for predicting one output characteristics in terms of other variables. So the output characteristics or output variable is there. In rapid miner, you have to specify it as a label. So any one of the field is an output variable, and we are planning to develop a model for any relation of output with other variables. That output field should be treated as a label. And all other fields which is used for modeling, like input variables or process variables, they are all should be treated as attributes. So these are the three common ways we define the variables. Either it will be an ID that will not be used for any analysis, or it can be an attribute, or it will be a label like that. So there are Rebel will be generally only one field. Most of them are just the output characteristic. All others will be your attribute type. So in this case, if you look at our data, so it is for each circle, each month-wise, what is the different parameters of that circle is given. What is last month usage, or current month usage, last 3 month usage, average recharge, projected growth, like that. So based on the business knowledge, the process knowledge, you can you will know that which all the fields are attributes and which one is label like that. Some data set may not have any label also, all will be attribute like that. So in this particular data set, the circle is label and the others are the attributes. So that way you have to define it. So our label will be mostly the output characteristics which you want to model or which you want to predict. And the other input or process variable, they are the attributes. Or label in other statistical terms, label will be the dependent variable and the attributes are the independent variables. So in this case, we will make this circle as a label. And even if you wrongly identify also, you can come back and change also. Then we'll click finish. So this read Excel operator is already set up. Now if you execute it, it will import to that data set. And here one log window is there, any problem is there to show, some error is there. This much you have diagnosed. Now let us run this operator and see whether it is reading the file or not. So to see the output, every operator, now there is an input and output. So if you want to see the output, this output should be connected to this corner. Just click here and drag to this one. So some operators will have more than one output and more than one input. So read file will not have any further input, but output will display the output characters, output part. So like this this is how we design the process of analysis. Now we execute and we will get the result. So right now if you execute, you will see that file is imported to RapidMiner. This much you have done now. Now you click on this button, it will execute.
Mexico Day, generator automatically go to the output window. If it's not going, then you click on this icon and all the output will come. Many times you will have more than one output, so it will come as different tabs. This overview tab will not contain much information, so you click on the next one. here we are reading the data, no, to get the result. And wherever it is missing, no, missing values, it will be a question mark. And this data set also, there are different views. This whatever you are seeing is the data view. So this is the data view. Then there is a metadata view that gives you the summary. So which are the different fields? Then what is the type? And what is the average? It is a numeric variable, average and variation it will give you. Otherwise, it will give a count, which value is the highest number of times it is occurring. The last column is any value is missing or not. So metadata view gives you the summary of that characteristic. And data view gives the full data. And there is a plot view which can be used for seeing the relationship using different plots. Time being we will not do that. First we will see the missing values, how you will do. Then we will see the plots. So when we read an Excel file, you can look into the summary by metadata view. You can see the full data and the data view. And if you want to see the interrelationships between the character and fields, we have to go to the plot view and make the different plots. So this is how we import the file. If it is an Excel file, you have to use the read Excel. CSV means read CSV like that, or any lot of formats are there. Any of the formats you can use the corresponding operator. And all the path you may not remember, it varies from version to version. So in the operator window, you just type and search it window. Then you drag it to the process window. So I will show you once again. Then we will proceed. So we have just started only. First step we are seeing is how to import our data set to RapidMiner package. So we have given you a set of data, demo data sets. So one of that files is missing values telecom. That is an Excel file. It contains four fields: current month usage, last 3 month usage, average recharge, projected growth, and one circle for different circles. So circles is the other field. So first we will read or import this data set to RapidMiner. Then there are some missing values. Will you handle that missing values? After reading up the missing values, the remaining file, how will you save it back? These are the three things we are going to do now. So all over the desktops, this RapidMiner is already installed. So you can see that RapidMiner icon. You just double click or open it, it will start. So you will get this amazing. Now we are starting with a new process. Every analysis will be considered as a process. So with the new analysis means we have to start with the new process. Or if you already have done some work and we have to continue, means you can open that also. But here it is a new process. So click on new process. So we get this screen. And this is the design screen of our RapidMiner. So all of the analysis process we have to design it here. And the result will come to the output window after execution. And this one has many parts. 3 parts are very important. Spending this process window. Here only we set up the analysis process or design it. And every analysis is done through one respective operator. So in the left hand side, you will see all the different operators available. So based on our required analysis, the corresponding operator we have to use it for the analysis. So And every operator, you have to set up some parameters. So once the that properties you come here, as per our requirement, we have to choose it. So right now what we are going to do is, we are going to import one Excel sheet. So for importing Excel sheet or Excel file, this is the operator we have to use, read Excel. And the read is the operator we use group for reading or importing different file formats. For Excel, it is read Excel. So, graphic minder. So, here in under operators, you know, you can search. If you don't remember the path, you can search read Excel. If you write to read itself, all the different file formats it will support, you know. We require read Excel, no? So click on that and grab and drop it in the process window. Now we have to give the parameters of this operator, where that file path and all we have to specify. So for that, you select this one. Then its properties will come here. And we can use this configuration wizard. You click on that button, the properties. Click on configuration wizard. So the file open dialog box will pop up. Then it browse to the folder. So in this particular system, the data set is in the desktop. Desktop, rapid miner folder, data set, and missing value telephone. This dictionary is there. Data set and missing values telephone. And directly you don't go to finish now. We go step by step. Go to the next. So it will give you a preview of some initial records. Then again next. Third step is very important. So here you can decide many things. One is suppose some of the fields are not required for your analysis. If you don't want to read that, you just uncheck the box. Then that field will not be read. So for example, if you don't want serial number, you uncheck. So the only other fields will be important to RapidMiner. Then every field, it will identify the data type. Data type means whether it is a test variable, numeric variable, within numeric, whether it's a real number, integer, polynomial, different types are there. So many types it will support. So in this case, this current month usage, last 3 month usage, average, recharge, projected growth, all you take it as numeric. So polynomial, if you want to change into numeric, click on the drop down and then take numeric. And the last column is a field test column, no? So let it be polynomial, let it see like that. Now in data mining, most of the activities are classified into two types. One is called as supervised learning, and another one is unsupervised learning. For both, there are many techniques, statistical techniques and machine learning techniques. In supervised learning, is basically a predictive modeling technique. We develop models. Model to predict what the field in terms of other fields. If you get the values of other fields using this model, it will predict the output, the other field. So the field or the variable which you want to predict, that will be called as response or output. In rapid miner, we have to specify it as level. And the other characteristics or fields which we use for predicting, that will be called as attributes. So in supervised learning, when we are using, there should be at least one labels and some attributes. Unsupervised is not a modeling technique, only a grouping technique. There all of them can be attributes also. So in this case, you can see that it has identified everything as attributes. So in this circle, if you want, we can change it to leisure. you are normally a forgotten to set up this thing. Then you click finish. So now if you execute it, this operator will run. And if you want to see the output, then what happened is that this output port will connect to this corner port. Otherwise, no display will come. You can execute, but you will not get this output. Every operator will have one or more input and output ports. Summary will be there. Whether it is numeric or non-numeric, any missing values are there. Then some statistics, so range of the hardest, minimum to maximum, or the count. If it is test data, polynomial count, how many A's, how many B's, like that. And also average and variation. Some summary will get. And we can also show it as a plots also. So the plots we will see little later. Now using these two icons, we can always move from output to design and design to output. Now we will come back. Nothing is not
non-plus, I got this data set. One option is I replace it with average. Suppose all the missing values in current month usage, you can replace with the average value of that. So based on one thing is not you can use average, or based on the requirement, sometimes you replace with the zero, maximum value, minimum value. Like that, different ways you can replace it. So in our print minor, how will you do the data set? So you go back to the design window, design screen. Now to replace this missing values, the operator for that we have to take. So there is a replace operator is there. Replace missing values operator we can take. You can search here itself, replace. So it comes under data cleansing, replace missing values to take. So you drag this and keep it here. Also, if you want, you connect it to the output port. So before missing values, means when we read the data, how the data will look like, that also it will show, and also after replacement also it will show. So some operators you may have more than one output. Now this operator parameter properties we have to set up here. Like this one you don't change it now, only the replace. So here what is that? It will show, ask you which are the operators you want to replace. So by default you take all operators. And second one is all the missing values, so what value you want to replace. So default is average. There are many maximum, minimum, average. So whatever value you give. So different ways you can replace. Then let us take it as average. Then we'll see other cases also. So if you run this, what it will do is first it will read that data set. Then for all the fields having missing values, it will compute the average for all the non-missing values column wise, and all the missing values will be replaced with the
same column itself.
Column field wise average it will take, and missing values will be replaced with average. Since both of the output it will display because we have given original data and final data also. So you run it now. So you see three outputs now. Result overview dot required. Example set is the input, the input data. And example set after replacement is the replacement signal. So if you click on this example set, in Excel you see the original data set. All of you got it, no? See, if you look at this second field, current month usage. This tail record it is missing, no? Question mark means it is missing. Then which one, 10th one also missing. Current, two question marks. Now you go to after replacement, the next tab, example set replace missing values. you see that the thread value is not missing. It has got as 5.975. And 10 knots are below 5.975. So all the missing values, it has replaced with 5.975. This is the average of last that particular field. And it has done for all the fields. All other fields also corresponding average it has given. The missing values are replaced with the corresponding averages. For example, if you take average usage, average return, third one is missing and the 13th one is also missing. Here you can see that third one is replaced with the .2 and 13th one also is replaced. So that's the 3.2. Which are the ones missing? You can see that it will be replaced with the averages. But it is not necessary to always show go by average. When it is a totally new data, we don't know the background and all. So one best option is you replace with average. But the some parameters like some financial figures and all, we may replace it to zero or maximum. Depends on your particular domain knowledge, we have to choose which is an appropriate replacement value. This much all of you don't know. Now there is one more option in RapidMiner. In this option, what happens is when we do average, it replaces all the fields with average. Well, there is a situation, some fields we don't want to replace with average, but some other value, that is also possible. So how will you do that? Let us see now. Everywhere we don't go with average, each field we can choose the different options for replacement. There is one this thing, a two parameters are hidden. We expand that. Then this edit list button you open. I'll tell you once again. First you expand that one. Then this edit list you take. Columns edit list. Then here, you have come up to this one, no? Here some, something is written, two operators are given. In your case, it is there? You just click on that, you will expand it. Then you get these options, columns edit list. So click on the edit list. So in this left hand side drop down list, we can choose one by one different fields. Say suppose we take the average recharge, first one. And right hand side, you will ask, replace with the watt measure. So anyone you can take. So let us take average for the first one. Now you click the, so not circle, no. Circle, there is nothing to replace. Average recharge, the average. Now the next one, some other one, you click on this add and play button. So one more thing will come. Here you choose another field, maybe current month usage. You want to replace with some other parameters, say maximum. Then current month usage, all values will be replaced with maximum. It will not be average. Last 3 month usage, missing values, if you want to replace with 0, you give 0. So from that options, you can choose different ones. But there should be some logic now. Just like that, you choose something. When nothing is not better, you choose average. Otherwise, you should have some justification why I take that. So now we apply and run it. So then what it will do is, first we will replace missing values with average. Second one will replace missing values with the maximum of that field. L1 or DC minus super intensity to 0. However, whichever way you design the setup the process, accordingly that is going to be called.
Last frequency.
So the second column, no? Fifth one and third one are missing, no? So it just comes to 0 like that.
Zero. Last frequency.
Maximum like that. Whichever way you choose it, same way it is. The order may not change the way to get the order.
For replacement, that is your original ORI, you know. Then example is the output after the sentence after the source or run on that. Third one, if you give some summary, it will replace with mean or something.
If I
don't,
how to disconnect?
Just click on it.
CSV file.
expand like that, you save as CSV now. Then what you have to do is, instead of read Excel, you take read CSV operator. So first you save that file as CSV, then you take read CSV operator. Again, you use that import configuration wizard. You are with me now up to this one. Then you browse to that folder. Only four CSV files will be there. This one you take, data relation VCA. Title, no? Next. Here, this column separation, no? You choose a comma. That's the only thing we have to do. Column separation is comma. So first you have to save it as a CSV file. Then instead of read Excel, you will make a read CSV. And then you just command so comma separated, then next you come here. Is my all of you so this respondent ID, no, this column we don't require for principal component analysis. So you uncheck this first one. And here we are not developing any model. So all the access should be attributes. There is no label or anything else. All are attributes. All of them should be attributes. And this data type you can make it as numeric. All of them numeric. Required. All of this data type should be numeric and attribute. Then you finish. So we have to bring everything into the same scale. So method of scaling, this scaling is called normalization. You have to normalize your data. I will tell you what is meant by this scaling and all. Suppose your data is like that, and if you try to suppose you do a dimensionality reduction in this data, then what happened is that mostly it will take care of cost only, because cost is a very large scale in thousands. It will not consider duration of shipment, will not have any impact. So what we do is, when our data is like that, different fields are at different units or different scales, we do a normalization, bring everything into the same scale. So there are two types of normalization. One is called the min-max transformation or min-max. So min-max transformation, what we do is, from each data, you minus the minimum value and divide by maximum minus minimum. So then all the values will come between minimum and 0 and 1. So this way all the variables will come between 0 and 1. Another one is called sieve transformation. In this case, what we will do is each value you minus the mean and divide by standard deviation. So both of the methods you can use. Actually, this is a scaling method. You can bring everything into the same scale. So I will show you first the first method. That is min-max method. For that, we have to compute the minimum and maximum. You need not know that. You just see it away. This is the Excel function for minimum, no? Minimum of each variable if you take. And maximum of each variable. Then minimax transformation means thank you.
after transformation, how the value will look like is like this. From which data point, you have to minus the corresponding minimum and divide it by maximum minus k. So 1.5 will become 0.132. So your data will transform like this. So the advantage is minimum becomes 0 and maximum becomes 1. Same thing you can do with the other variables also. Cost minus minimum of cost. So by doing this transformation, even though what will be the original data, after this everything will become zero between 0 and 1. You can make it between any two values, 0 and 100 like that. So before we do the dimensionality reduction, we do this one, transformation and make it into same scale. But for principal command analysis, so this transformation is called a min-max transformation. Each data value minus corresponding mean divided by range. So that the highest value becomes 1 and smallest becomes 0 and everything becomes between 0 and 1 for all variables. So first you have to normalize and then proceed for many analysis. Especially for this dimensionality reduction, we have to do it. Another way of doing it is using the second transformation. That is, from each data you minus the mean and divide by standard deviation. So for principal component, we have to use the second one. Second one, how will you do? It is slightly different. I will show it in another sheet. Since from minimum we require mean and then standard deviation. So mean is average. Transformation, each value minus mean divided by standard deviation. So this transformation, what it does is it will not make the minimum value 0 and maximum 1, but it will make the mean the standard 0 and the variation 1. This is another way of making doing a descale. So same thing we can do for other variables also. So here also mean becomes 0 and standard deviation becomes 0. Thank you.
transformation is called Z transformation. And most of the statistical analysis we do this only. We don't make the boundary same, but the center point same, mean same, and variation also uniform for all the variables. So here when we do principal component analysis, after we read the data, first we normalize it using the transformation. Then only we'll proceed. So what it means is like this. Convert all data in such a way that mean becomes zero for all fields and standard deviation becomes one. Some other analysis we go by the other method. That is, most of the machine learning techniques we use min-max transformation, neural network and all. And most of the statistical learning techniques we go by the second method. So here for principal component analysis we go by the second one. So now let us, I will close this and let us see the RapidMiner, how will you do that. So after reading the data, next one is we have to normalize. So there is an operator called normalize. This one, no? This normalized operator will come. You read that. This type normalize, it comes under somewhere. Cleansing, no? Under cleansing normalization it comes. But you just type normalize, it will come. Numerical value like that. Numerical value modification normalize. Then this output will connect to this input. Data reading the data should pass on to the normalized setting. And only one is required, but if you want original data also you can connect here. And all the fields you have to normalize. And what type of normalization? One is the transformation. That is the second one. Delta minus mean by standard deviation. Then range transformation is the first one, mean max transformation. So there are many methods of normalization. We go by the first one. Okay. So all are default you can take here. But a RapidMiner can be used for other normalization purpose also. Some other analysis we may require that. So if you run it, you can see this is our original data. All values are between 1 to 7. After normalization, it all becomes mean 0 and standard deviation 1, like that it will come. So this is a pre-analysis we have to do before you go for dimensionality reduction. All of you done after this match. Normalized data you got, no? So if you go here and take this our original data, and if you look at that metadata, you can see that average is some 3.9, 4.1, and standard deviation maybe 1.9 and all. And if you go to normalized data and see metadata, you see all averages becomes 0 and standard deviation becomes 1. So this scale, bring it to everything in the same scale. So every time when you do this analysis, this is the first step you have to normalize. Now in principal component, what it does, it sees the correlation between the variables, and based on the correlation, it will form the factors or the components. So if there is no correlation, there is no point in further doing this analysis. So we can check whether there is a correlation or not. There is an operator to check correlation. Let us see that correlation operator. It comes under modeling only. So let us see correlation. This comes under modeling, no? Correlation and dependency analysis or something. Dependency computation. There is a correlation matrix. Take that correlation matrix. This output will pass to the correlation matrix. The correlation matrix also we want to bring it. First you read the data, normalize, then we can visually check whether there is any point in proceeding with the grouping the variables by correlation matrix. So this is the correlation matrix. Correlation matrix will give you pairwise relationship. X1 is related to X2, X3 like that. So you get the correlation matrix as your output. All of you got it? So first we do normalize. Then we do correlation. This is the matrix you got, no? Correlation coefficient. How it is computed, I will tell you in the afternoon when we go for modeling. But you have to remember is that that values will lie between minus 1 to plus 1. The values in this matrix, correlation coefficient will lie between minus 1 to plus 1. So, you didn't get that. What are this got it? Thank you. this values, you know, between this values will lie between minus 1 to plus 1. So if you get values close to minus 1 means, or plus 1 means, they are correlated. Minus 1 means they are negatively correlated. Plus 1 means positively correlated. Positively means when one value is high, other also will be high. Higher, larger values will be paired with larger values, and smaller values will be paired with smaller values. Negative correlation the other way. One variable is low, the other will be high. So both are relationship. But if you get values close to zero, means they are not correlated like that. So now we look at this table, we can get some idea about how the correlation structure is there. So you take this x1 column, how it is correlated with others, let us see. So x1 to x1 always 100% relationship will be there. That you don't take. But x1 to x2, it is minus 0.05, no, almost close to zero, negligible. So x1 and x2 are no relation. X1 with x3, there is a positive and almost strong correlation. 0.87 and all are very strong correlation. X1 with x4, almost negligible, very close to zero. X1 with x5, negative and all that also strong. So you can see that x1 is related to x, strongly related with x3 and x5. Same thing you will see in x3 also. It will be related to x1 and x5. And x5 will be related to x3 and x1. So that is the one type of correlation you can see here. That is x1, x3, x5 are very strongly related. Strong relationship is there. Then you see others, whether they have any relation. We go through x2, no? X2 to x1, anyway, no relation. X2 to x2, we need not consider. X2 to x3 also not very good. 0.15 only, no? Close to 1 like that. At least 0.6 and above comes only, you can say that there is a good relation, either in the positive side or negative side. Then x2 to x4. This may be the border case now. Somewhat relationship can be there with x4. And with x6, there is a reasonable correlation. So x2 is related, not very strong, but reasonable with x4 and x6, we can say. Similarly, x4 also, reasonable relation with x2 and x6. And x6 also related to some extent x2 and x4. So that is what we get. Very strong or high correlation between x1, x3, x5. So if you do a dimensionality reduction, it is a high chance that x1, x2, x1, x3, x5 will join together as one variable. And there is some reasonable or good correlation between x2, x4, x6. So they may form one or two factors. We don't know. May not be one, but at least two or like that. But still there is a correlation. It is a good idea to proceed. So 6 can be reduced to 2 or 3 like that. So this correlation matrix will give some hint whether going proceeding with this will be good or not, yield some result or not. So here is very likely that we may reduce this 6 into 3 or 2. That how it will do, that how it will do, let us see now. So we'll come back to this one. So we'll proceed now. So now this correlation we can remove. This only check we are doing, no? We can now, from here itself, we can now do the dimensionality reduction. So now the matrix operator required is the principal component. Principal component analysis is there, no? That you keep. Also you can connect, then unnecessary one more output will be created. So this you connected, no? From normalize PCA, or after correlation also you can connect in ESA to this. Now its parameters you have to do dimensionality reduction. You keep it as none. Initially start with the none. Okay? This much you are done. No other parameter, only none you have to keep. Run it. So how many output has created? Only that correlation matrix you will not see because that is taken out. That is also there, you will have got one more output. Now first you have to look into this one now, this PCA thing. You see the matrix you will get. From the, what if you got this result? Or it got something else? PCA tab, you click on that PCA tab. So what it gives you is that there are six components. Six components means six factors it has created. That is the maximum possible. No, maximum possible is equal to the number of original variables. And then there is a column called standard deviation. Then proportion of variance and cumulative proportion of variance. So this table you got it, no? All of you got it, no? Later. First you come to PCA. All of you got it, no? Now, from this, how will you interpret this letter? I will tell you. So this standard deviation you got it, no? And if you square the standard deviation, you get the variance. If you square the standard deviation, you get to the variance. And this variance is nothing but the eigenvalues of your correlation matrix. So this correlation matrix, it has done an eigen and value analysis. Eigenvalues and eigen vectors. But it is this eigenvalues are nothing but the variance. In statistical terms, this is nothing but the variance. And variance means how much information is contained in that variable. So you will see that the variance in the decreasing order and or its the square root also will be decreasing order. So what it is showing is that whatever information we captured through that six questions, out of which around 2.732 has now taken care by the first principle from another first factor itself. And whatever is left out by the first one, another 2.217 is taken care by the second one. And whatever is left out by second, first and second, and the point 0.4 will be principal component 3, 4 like that. So towards the end, there won't be much information will not be there. And if you sum the variance, it will come to 6. Why it is coming to 6? You have six fields, not only six fields, because we did a normalization, no. So after normalization, the standard deviation of each one becomes 1, no? So this variance is nothing but its square. So the square also will be 1. So each variable has, so the information contained is transformed into 1 unit. So overall it is 6. So what this matrix is telling is that out of the total information you captured through that survey is made it is equal to 6. That will be equal to the number of variables because each one has 1 variance. Out of that 6, 2.732, initially all the 6 are equally important, but after doing the principal component, the importance changes. Out of 6, 2.732 of information is going taken care by the first component itself. Whatever is left out by the first one, another 2.217 is taken by the second. Whatever is left out by first and second, 0.4 third, in that order it is going. So always the first one will be most important, then second one like that. And towards the end, it may not contain much information, that can be ignored. So So our next question is how many of them we should pick up. And the next column is proportional variance. So this 45.45 is nothing but 2.73 divided by 6. 36 is 2.21 divided by 6. So in other words, what it is telling is that out of the total information you captured through so many variables, in this case it is survey, in this survey, around after principal component analysis, 45% can be represented by one principal component itself. And the remaining 55%, another 36 will be taken care of by the second one. And whatever is left out by first and second, 7% goes to third, 5% goes to the fourth, like that. And the last column is the cumulative. That is, first component alone will take 45%. First and second together will be 82%. First, second, third is 9, together is 90%, like that. So you can see that this 3, 4, 5 and all may not contribute much, contain much information. So after forming this principal component, we pick up the important ones, which contains majority of the information which we captured. So you look at this table and this will tell you how many principal components or how many new factors we require. Okay, there are many criteria used. The first one is based on this variance or eigenvalues, or you can look at the standard deviation. So the variance criteria is that you will pick up the principal components which has variance at least equal to 1. 1 or more. Any principal component having variance or eigenvalue 1 or more, that should be retained. Because the total information is 6, and 6 is for 6 variables. So if you take the average, average will be always 1. So all the components for the new variables which has average or more information, that are important that we have to keep. There is a logic we pick up 1 and above. So that is one way of looking into this one. So how many are required? How many principal components we have to retain? How many of them have more than 1? 2. Now the top 2 only we require. All the 6, whatever information you captured through 6 questions can be now represented by these 2 new variables. We don't require others. So one criteria, that is the statistical or scientific criteria, is to look at variance. But rapid minor will not give you variance. So look at standard deviation. Wherever standard deviation of 1 or more, it will be always in the decreasing order. So you look from the top to bottom. Wherever it is 1 or more, those components we have to retain. Otherwise you can ignore. That is one criteria. Another one is based on the cumulative proportion. Because some other techniques, like singular value decomposition and all, will not give you eigen values. So there you have to use this cumulative proportion of variance criteria. So wherever it is close to around 60 to 70%, only those variables you have to keep, those factors. So if you take the first principal component alone, it will take care only 45%. That is not sufficient. So first and second together, 82%. That is more than the minimum required. So that way also you require only 2 factors or 2 components. So any one of the criteria you can use. The first one is more scientific, that is the logic. The second, cumulative proportion, is a thumb rule kind of a thing. 60%, 70% you look at it. In this particular problem, both gives you the same result. We require the 2 principal components only. So that is the first thing, first conclusion we have to arrive by looking at this summary output. Eigenvalues, how many principal components or how many factors we require. Now the next step is we want to know how these factors are formed. How the factors are formed, it will be by multiplication with the weights, no. So next thing is we have to see the weights. So the weights, how will you see is that, see rapid minor is already prepared the weights also. So here you see that in this PCA, what you are seeing is this eigen values, no. The next column is eigen vectors. You take the eigen vectors. So that gives you the weight. So each of this x1, x2, x3, up to x6, how it is related to each of the principal component, that weights are given there. So, but we require only first two columns, no? The third and fourth panel you can ignore. Only take the PC1 and PC2 dates. So, from that we will know how the components are formed. This is how we got, no? So, for the first two principal component, the W1 is minus 0.5, W2 is 0.18. W3 is point minus 0.5 like that. Second one is the second one. Third onwards we don't require because we are only focusing on the first and second factors. So this will the eigen values, eigen vectors will give you these weights. So you don't take all the weights, only first and two. Now you look at the weights, then you will know how this the factors are formed. For example, if you take the first component, which all excess have more weights on that, positive or negative doesn't matter, but look at the values, you can see that now, all of them will not be equal weightage, no, the weightage will be different. So if you look at the first one, principal component one, you can see that X1 has a higher weightage, minus 0.5, no? Minus you leave it, 0.5, but X2's weightage is very low compared to X1. And X3 has a high weightage, X5. So X3, X1, X3, X5 has a high loading or high weightage than principal component 1. Or in other words, these three are joined together and form the first component. That is the correlation structure we have seen also in our data. So eigenvalue analysis will extract that. So instead of X1, X3, X5, all of them can be joined together in a single component. That will be the first component. And how the values will get, you multiply these weights with their scores. Not the original scores, normalize the scores, you multiply and submit, you get the value for each person. That is PC1 value, PC2 value like that. Now if you look at second one, wherever the variable weightage is more than principal component 1, its weightage on second should be generally low. So the principal component will form like that. Every original variable how? High weightage in only one way principal component. So X1, X3 and X5 will definitely will have low weightage on the second component. And other set of correlation will come as second component. So the second one you see high weightage is on X2, X4 and X6. So whatever information we captured through X2, X4, X6, that is now combined and formed as second variable, second component. So now instead of working on looking on six variables, we have to work on only two of them. The first one will take care of three questions or three variables, X1, X3, X5. And the second one will take care of X2, X4, X6. Why it has happened? Because there is a relationship. So this the people who responded, this is a survey now. So the people who responded think that these three questions are related. In other words, whoever has given high rating for X1, they are given high for X3 and X5 also, based on positive or negative. Similarly for the other set of questions. So there is an interrelationship, something common among these four variables. That is what it is formed as a factor or a component. So now if you look at, you have to now explain what is this principal component 1 means, what is the principal component or factor 2 means. Because principal component 1 is the questions X1, X3 and X5 and 2 is X2, X4, X6. So what is common among these questions if you look into, you will know the meaning of these components. So we'll go back to the questions and see whether any relationship is there. So 1, 3 and 5, no? So the first two question is that toothpaste should prevent the cavities. Third question is, you should strengthen your gums. And fifth one is a negatively weighted question. That means flour is better. That's why that correlation has come negative. That is, the prevention of tooth decay is an important thing. So people say these three are related and they are given more or less similar type of rating for these three questions. And they are joined together as one factor. So what is common among these three questions, that is what the first component will take care. So this way, no? Prevention of cavities, strong gum, and prevention of tooth decay, all the three are
coming together as one, you know, one variable. So you can see that all these three are some health related benefits of your teeth. So there are three questions, three different aspects of health we are asked. But by this thing, it has joined together as a single factor, that is health related benefit. So first component is representing the health related benefits consumers seek. And similarly, the other one we can see. 2, 4, and 6, no? Toothpaste should give shiny teeth. It should freshen your breath and should provide attractive teeth. Anything common among them? That's not related to health of the teeth, no? Shiny teeth, attractive teeth and all. Some other aspects, no? Like social benefits or aesthetics or look and feel kind of benefits. So three questions are like have something common among these six questions that are addressing the social benefits or look and feel benefits. So they are joined together and form as the second factor. So first one is health related benefits, second one is social or aesthetic benefits. So the conclusion is that even though you asked many aspects, many different types of benefits consumers seek through different questions, now you can find out that after this analysis, each one are not totally different. They have some relationship. They can be joined, put together into two different types of benefits. One is people may seek health related benefits. Another one is people may invest in social benefits. Now, as if you are a toothpaste manufacturer, for you only done this survey means you have to really think about your product gives what kind of benefits and what strategies we develop. You need not to go for each and every question or variable separately. Only the common things only we have to address. That is the purpose. So, when we collect data on a very large number of fields or variables, either through survey or through measurement, there can be interrelationship. Each one separately looking and analyzing sometimes become difficult. Then we do this dimensionality relation. So if there are inter variables are interrelated, it will join together and form us new variables. Each new variable is a weighted sum of original ones. But it every original variable will have a high weightage only on one of the new variables. So then we have to interpret what is the new variable and what strategies we can develop based on that. So suppose the person, the manufacturer who has done this survey, his product is more of focusing on health related benefits, then you can see who are the competitor in that category. And he can even increase his market share by having another sister product addressing the other component or other benefits also. That way also they can improve their business. So those are the different types of usage of doing the dimensionality relation. Instead of going each and every requirement, it will then you combine them and form some common requirements or common aspects. And that will be the number of that common things will be less than the original one. So you have to work only with less number of questions or less number of variables. That will be always better than working with large number. Purpose of doing this dimensionality relation. Generally, it is done on a lab when we have data on very large number of variables. Then we have to do this. It may not be possible to manage each one separately. So we explore the interrelationship among them and combine them. So with the combinement, there will be something in common. The common thing will be the new factor of component will address. So we have to work on only that common aspect. That is the purpose. And one more thing is that now these 30 people have participated in survey. So for each person, we can find out one score for component 1 and one score for component 2. How will you get the score for the component 1? These are the weights now. These weights you multiply with the normalized data. Component 1 weights, you multiply as sum, you get the value of the person's component 1 value. And second component weights, if you multiply and take the sum, you will get it.
Now when we go it through rapid miner or any other package, it will compute that and give it to us also. For the already available data, it has computed that and given to us. So that is another output you will get. That is this example set PCN. So this first value is this first person's data, this six values multiplied with the corresponding weight of first component and sum it up. Similarly for second one, like that. Third onwards you don't look, you only first and second we have to take. So that is given for 30 people, first and second values. This one 15 and 16 to 30. Even though it gives by default, but we can also manually convert. You multiply the weights and sum, you will get. Now, what is the use of this one? No? Generally, the survey, many people will, when it is a consumer survey and all, large number of people will participate. Now, if you look at this first person, now, or the second person, if you see that the PC1 value is higher than PC2 value, what is the meaning? Represents health-related benefits. No, second one is social benefits. So somebody gives a very high score for this one means mostly he is more interested in health-related benefits compared to the other one. So all the people who participated in the survey can be put into four groups. One group is the people having high rating for PC1 and low for PC2. Those are more interested in health-related benefits. So there is another group, the reverse. Maybe like the seventh person. He has a positive score for PC2 and negative for PC1. So those are more interested in social or aesthetic benefits than health related benefits. And there can be a third group, they want both.